Good evening, friends. Welcome to Inspiring Conversations. We have a very interesting guest in Anshulika Dubey, who is the co-founder of a very interesting concept called Wishberry. Anshulika Dubey is a very outstanding performer in her life and has been featured in the Forbes as well. She has been speaking on various platforms and television channels, expressing her ideas and giving details about what Wishberry is all about. Friends, she is a very powerful and a very interactive orator, and you'll experience that during this session. Wishberry is a rewards-based crowdfunding website for creative entrepreneurs in India. It was started in 2012 by Ex-McKinsey analyst Priyanka Agarwal and Anshulika Dubey. Creative artists entrepreneurs in India can use Wishberry to raise funds for their projects from their fans and followers. People who fund these projects are called as backers, and in return for their funding, they get exclusive rewards related to the project, such as access to the first copy of the project, a chance to work with the project creators such as filmmakers, musicians, etc. A limited edition merchandise is also forwarded. Friends, Wishberry is a new way to bring creative and innovative ideas to life. Lack of money and social validation discourages people from pursuing their creative passions in India. Both the founders, that is Anshulika Dubey and Priyanka Agarwal, believe that the only solution to this problem is to democratize funding through an online platform like Wishberry. People who connect with ideas can back these ideas with funding, not for charity or for any monetary return, but simply for making ideas happen. They believe crowdfunding will put India on the creative map of the world. Their mission is to build a community of believers who back ideas and who can help India produce more creative entrepreneurs such as filmmakers, musicians, writers, dancers, theater artists, and many more. Just not focused on engineering or MBAs as the world does. Friends, Wishberry is a crowdfunding concept, a concept which is not known to most of us. Through today's inspiring conversation session and our interaction with Anshulika Dubey, we will explore the idea of crowdfunding and also why she began this journey as an entrepreneur, what are her thoughts behind it, what excites her, and how does she manage this business differently from how others do their business. I bring to you Anshulika Dubey. Let's enjoy the conversation with her. Good evening, friends. Today we are doing the 24th session of Inspiring Conversations, and I am very happy to announce that today's guest is one of the youngest that we have had till today. But they say that age doesn't matter. Even at such a young age, she has been already listed on the Forbes for the activity that she has done. So, Anshulika, please. Anshulika, it's a very interesting journey that you've had after being an ex-McKinsey and after seeing the shores of US. You come back to the country and get involved with a very fantastic concept called Wishberry to a country which doesn't know what is crowdfunding. So fortunately, you are also managing a similar concept in the US with McKinsey, researching on crowdfunding and social initiatives. Yeah. So you came back. Wishberry is a very attractive and a very nice word. Samir will always say name matters a lot because that's how it lasts longer in the memory of people. Why Wishberry? What's behind the name?
Okay, so we have a very confusing history. Priyanka, who unfortunately could not be here, my co-founder, she started Wishberry as a very different business. It started first as a business for advertising on taxis. Then she moved on to doing wedding gift registry online. So there's a concept in the US where, you know, you can tell your friends what, you know, they should give you in marriages. And you register that with a, you know, store and people go and buy those things. So that was originally the name of Wishberry, like whatever you wish you get kind of stuff. But she started as an entrepreneur much before I joined her. She started in 2009 with all these concepts and, you know, she was trying something and pivoting and, you know, whatever was not working or working.
And people generally cross seven seas for the boy, crosses seven seas for the girl.
I say that a lot, yeah.
And you crossed it for another girl.
Yes, yes, absolutely. So Wishberry happened because of her, meaning the name. And we didn't change it because it also went with the whole spirit of crowdfunding, which is whatever you are dreaming of, that can come true. So whatever you wish can come true.
So in a paragraph, how will you explain crowdfunding? Because there is a very thin edge between crowdfunding and collective investment schemes. A collective investment scheme is an illegal criminal act.
I've been explaining this for the last 5 years. So dealing with people in India who are very, very, you know, glued to paisa diya hai to kuch wapas milega kind of mentality. Whoever you explained crowdfunding to, they were like, acha to profit kya hai? So and this is a very, very Western concept. It is, forget about being Western, it's a philanthropic concept. Where if you like an idea, you give it 500 rupees. That's it. You know? Through online, we can reach out to a lot of people. So for example, if I'm a filmmaker and I want to make a film in 10 lakhs. Now I can keep chasing that one person to give me 10 lakhs for months. And if somebody gives me 10 lakhs in one go, obviously he will come with a lot of expectations. He will ask for profit. He will also maybe get into creative control, all sorts of things to just make sure that he gets most bang for his buck. But then what if we enabled this filmmaker to go to 1,000 people and ask for 1,000 rupees each, right? This concept works for those filmmakers who are budding filmmakers, who cannot convince because they don't have any, you know, legacy or credibility of films that they have done in the past. So when you start doing that, the person who's giving 1,000 rupees is not thinking of anything in return because it's just 1,000 rupees and he knows that he's giving it to support that filmmaker. So all these films that are offbeat, intelligent, go into Cannes and, you know, all sorts of film festivals abroad, but don't get a release in PVR because they do not have Salman Khan in it or Shah Rukh Khan in it and all sorts of masala. Where do they go? They are very, very good films and people don't get to see them. So for them, crowdfunding came across as a complete boon.
And what is the difference between crowdfunding and collective investment schemes?
So collective investment is simply that, you know, I am giving you 1,000 rupees or 2,000 or whatever, but in return, I'm getting something back.
In money.
It could be interest, it could be profit.
So that is illegal.
If you announce it publicly and you say that, you know, I'm going to give you back monetary things, then it is illegal because then you're acting like a public company.
Yes.
And
yes,
you're not
yes.
a public company.
So crowdfunding is basically you pay money to somebody that you follow as a fan.
Correct.
To a musician or an artist
yes.
or a filmmaker.
Yes.
And you get some privileges in return against that.
Privileges in return. So like if I'm a filmmaker, I'm making a film and you give me 1,000 rupees, I will give you the link to watch the film first. And you don't have to go to the theater. If you give me 5,000 rupees, I'll call you for the premiere of the film, make you sit with the cast and crew. If you give me 10,000 rupees, I will give you name in the credits of the film, maybe a role also. You know, people come with various innovative rewards also.
So Wishberry actively got into crowdfunding in 2012, but technically into the crowdfunding activity.
Yes,
in
2012. Yeah.
But I think crowdfunding initially happened in 1976
yes.
when a film called Manthan
yes.
was funded by 5 lakh farmers in Gujarat. Each paid 2 rupees, collected 10
yeah,
lakhs
yeah.
and made the film.
So
that's
Benegal,
also, Shyam yeah. Benegal did that.
So basically, if you remember the first cooperative ad of Amul, they wanted to tell everybody about their milk revolution. And Shyam Benegal said, we'll need 5 lakhs for it and 10 lakhs for it. And at that time, nobody had money. So they went to the Gujarat farmers, all of them gave 2 rupees each. And if you look, if you ever come across the poster of Manthan, it doesn't say Shyam Benegal presents Manthan. It says 5 lakh farmers of Gujarat present Manthan. So that's basically what it is.
So out of the films that you have funded, there are three films which has won national awards.
Yeah.
One is Gunga Pehlwan.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
And these are small budget documentary type of films which have made it big.
Fascinating story. So the one thing that I've learned in while doing crowdfunding is that all filmmakers in the film industry are engineers. They were engineers and then they moved on to doing things that they really wanted to do. So similar story about these three kids from a management institute. They found out a story of this wrestler in Haryana who is actually deaf. He's a deaf and dumb wrestler, but he's got India 3 gold medals. His name is Virinder Singh in the Olympics that happened for the deaf and dumb people. But nobody knew about him. If you even Googled him, you would not be able to find out who this person is. So these three kids from this management school thought that Ispit a film banni chahiye. We should tell his story to the world. So yeah, they raised, they just wanted 3-4 lakh rupees to go and shoot in his, you know, place and all. And this was their first film out of college. They weren't even expecting anything. So I remember when their campaign went live on Wishberry, 3 lakhs was their amount, target amount. And one woman from the US saw it online and gave 1.5 lakhs. So ek aadha to aise ho gaya. And then a bunch of other people, I think about 300 people eventually funded this film. And then it won a national award in the best documentary debut film as well. So that was a very big deal.
So Wishberry, like any other enterprise for whom you raise funds, this is a concept that you all started, you and Priyanka started.
Yeah.
You also needed funds. And you have got some best names in the industry who have funded. So 45 people in the beginning itself got them a fund of 4 crores. So what, as an entrepreneur, was your pitch to them? It is not that 4 crores which is more interesting. It is more interesting of who gave those 4 crores.
Right.
So there is the MD of Google, and then there is Mohandas Pai. So how did you reach out to such unreachable people? That's one question.
Mm-hmm.
And what was your pitch which gave the investments into your company?
Yeah, so fundraising for this concept was a journey in itself. So earlier, I think one thing that Priyanka is really good in is that she approaches an investor when she is in a position of bargaining. You know, so she's like, she doesn't approach when she's fully aware that, you know, now we have something to show and, you know, we don't have to prove anything right now. So for the first year, or maybe actually 2 years, we did not approach anybody. We thought, let's just prove this concept. I think after we had some 3-4 crores raised for about 100 projects is when we thought, okay, now let's just start going. So in the process, in the 2 years, we had started meeting a lot of people. So through them, we could reach out to these people. We had built some goodwill and stuff. So,
and what was your pitch?
I think our pitch was very simple. It was that we just want to put India on the creative map of the world. We are very sick of the fact that everybody has to do engineering and doctor and all of that. And I myself, actually, I'm a closeted artist. If I was not doing McKinsey, I would have been a dancer and a singer. I was training to do that in school. But I remember my parents never encouraging me for this role because they thought that there's no money in it.
So if you would have had that kind of money, would you have yourself invested in a Wishberry type of a concept?
Absolutely. I think it's a slam dunk. I mean, it's very simple. If I like some artist and he's asking me for 500 rupees, why will I not give? I won't even think twice.
Investments. 3 crores, 4 crores.
Yeah, yeah.
The type of investments that
correct,
came in.
Correct. So I will absolutely.
You would have done that.
Yeah, absolutely.
Now tell me, there is a first mover advantage kind of a concept that we all know.
Yeah, yeah.
So there are two things to the first mover advantage. You can either be a super hit or you can be a flop. Why nobody is doing it? Because nobody finds it interesting. Why somebody is doing it? Because he got the Eureka moment and he realized this is an idea that can really work.
Yes.
What was your confidence when you began crowdfunding? Because when you began this concept, it is more of educating the people what crowdfunding is than getting it crowdfunded.
Yeah.
So how did you do that?
So I think we were very focused. Right after we started, we were the first crowdfunding platforms to start in India. And I think within months, just how herd mentality is in the country, there are 2-3 other platforms also started. But they were not focusing on any sector. They were just crowdfunding platforms where if somebody wants to raise money for their cancer treatment, can also raise funds. If they want to have films to raise funds, they can go there. So they were not focusing on any sector. They were sector agnostic. That is one way of doing this business, absolutely. So we till date enjoy the first mover advantage because nobody in the creative industry knows any other platform other than Wishberry. Because we say that we are only for you guys, we don't have anybody else. And also when you say that, you also mean that I don't want to put a film project raising money next to an acid victim who's raising money. That will become so funny, right? That people will think who to fund. So that's why I think our focus helped us gain that popularity, made people gain confidence in us. That we are not just saying what we are saying, we also want to do so many more things.
A lot of people know Kickstarter as a very large organization for crowdfunding operating out of the US. Kickstarter and Indiegogo.
Yes.
These are some large boys, large players operating out of the US. How are you different than them?
Okay. So Indiegogo and Wishberry are completely different because Indiegogo is sector agnostic. Also, there are certain rules that different platforms follow. So for example, on Indiegogo, if you want to raise 10 lakhs, but if you end up raising only say 2 lakhs, you can take the money. But on Kickstarter, if your project goal is 10 lakhs, you cannot get anything less than that. So you will get 60 days to raise that money. If you're not able to raise it, the money simply goes back to people. That is the concept even on Wishberry. So Wishberry and Kickstarter are directly comparable because Kickstarter is only for creative industry and follows this rule. So the way we are different from hence Kickstarter is, so in India, crowdfunding is all about, or just any social media communication is all about marketing yourself, you know, pitching to the people and telling them this is my idea, fund in this. So when we started out, we realized that Indians are very shy. They don't want to talk about what they are doing in a manner that they are, you know, in confidence and all of that. So we thought, okay, I think we will have to handhold everything. We'll have to make their marketing plan. We will have to do the social media communication, which is not something that happens on Kickstarter.
So you give a complete wholesome support services.
Correct.
Even if the guy doesn't have the capabilities to project himself, you draft the plans for him.
Correct. Correct.
Now, we all know in business, in competition, the big fish eats up the small fish. Mm-hmm. In simple language, we call it mergers. And in crude way, it is takeovers. So has Kickstarter noticed you, and are they in the plans to approach you, or have you approached to them because they are large boys?
Right. So first, let me say that I'm a big fan of Kickstarter. Tomorrow, if Kickstarter comes and says, we want to acquire you, I'll be like, when and where do I sign?
I hope they watch this program. Somewhere.
So last month, I was in the US and I went to meet the Kickstarter people.
Oh, you've already done that?
Yes, I've already done that. I've been their fans in 2009. I mean, honestly, I started this because I saw Kickstarter during that McKinsey project and I thought this has to happen in the country. So I love that organization for what it is. It has always took a stand on creative industry, want to move it. The founders, all the three of them are creative artists. One of them is a musician, one of them is an artist and all of that. So they have a very different DNA. That is the only company I know in the world which turned a profit in 24 months. Uber has not, Amazon, I mean not Amazon, but the others, that Airbnb, and they took forever to, you know, break even and stuff. So these guys have been very focused, cost conscious. So I like that company as for its ideals. So we really wanted to go meet them. I wrote to the CEO and he just responded in 24 hours saying that, yes, absolutely come. We know what you're doing. And it was a fantastic meeting. He sat down, he asked everything from how do Priyanka and I divide our responsibilities to, you know, what is your goal? What is your vision? And we told them everything. So they did say that if we ever come to India, we will definitely talk to you.
So you have already broken the ice with them.
Absolutely. Yeah. Yes, that's. So, talent has been my biggest challenge.
That's for all of us here, actually.
My God, I mean, and I...
What is your formula for success in that?
You know, so I think I have the advantage of coming from McKinsey. So, McKinsey, I was in McKinsey for 4.5 years and I saw how McKinsey actually gives time to developing its talent. It will send them to multiple trainings, do a lot of feedbacks, have a little bit of a system where there is a buddy for your professional growth, one-on-one. So we had a lot of these HR tactics that I had gone through in McKinsey. So I realized that it has to be hire fast, fire fast. If someone's not performing, if someone is performing, then how do you push them to, you know, have a faster learning curve? And making that for them. So I think as leaders, you can't just say that, okay, you are doing good and your next objective is now to go to the next level. You have to actually make that person reach that level as well.
How do you make them believe in your passion? How do they get involved as passionate as you are? How do you do that?
So one of the things that we realized was that we have to take somebody who already is an artist. So there are lots of people who are closeted artists, right? In the country, they may be doing their corporate jobs, but on weekends, they want to sing and dance and do plays and, you know, all of that jazz. So when we interview, if we see that this person has And I'm not saying just as a hobby, but actual serious, you know, someone who's a good singer, but not could not do anything. So that solves that problem for us because they can feel the pain that we want them to feel for the creative industry. And other than that, I think being two women and so outspoken also kind of helps because they don't see this much.
They have got a very interesting punchline before their logo. Go fund yourself. You accidentally read it otherwise sometimes. So that's pretty bold and that's pretty interesting the way it's written. You do crowdfunding raising for others. How do you advertise yourself that this kind of services are available? That there is Wishberry which can help you to achieve your dreams of raising funds for achieving their dreams or goals. How do you reach out to people apart from social media?
So one thing that worked really well for us was word of mouth. And
but word of mouth is a very homeopathic treatment. It takes time.
And it is the best one. I'll tell you something. The way word of mouth, so the benefits of word of mouth are exactly like homeopathy. It will run forever. If someone today on anywhere today, so for example, say you come to a new city, right? And you want to find out a general physician, right? How do you find a general physician? You ask someone. Only when you get recommendations is when you go to a doctor, and doctors have been living on word of mouth. Otherwise, they wouldn't have ever been able to get patients if they didn't have. This is the same thing that is everywhere. You go to restaurants with recommendation, you go to doctors with recommendation, and that what that recommendation does is, A, it comes free of cost for the company. Second is, that person is not going to forget you because somebody told them about you. So with us, what happened, that say a filmmaker wanted to raise funds and he has a campaign page on Wishberry which says wishberry.in/film. When he posts this on his Facebook, all his friends are also filmmakers, you know, so they know that, okay, this guy is raising money, so maybe I can also for my film. So for us, I think for 2-3 years, we didn't spend anything on marketing. It was just coming through word of mouth. And it's, I mean, I know a lot of people might think that ye kaise ho raha hai and it's not possible, but at least for 3 years, we didn't have to.
So all the people for whom you raised funds, there are how many people? 300 people?
So there have been 375 projects.
375 projects. So these people become brand ambassadors for Wishberry,
yeah,
because
absolutely.
You help them achieve what
absolutely.
They wanted.
And they are in the same circles. They know a lot of musicians. They know a lot of dancers. They know a lot of filmmakers. And also the community is really small.
As an entrepreneur, did you face any legal challenges? Because when you talk about raising money from people, law comes into play. So have you ever faced any trouble, or you're above that with legal guidance?
Never, actually, because I think from the beginning we said that this is as simple as someone selling a service to the other person. I mean,
is the government educated on the concept of crowdfunding?
Absolutely.
That you give money
absolutely.
And you don't take money in return,
absolutely.
It's rewards.
In fact, if you go through the SEBI guidelines, when SEBI started researching on crowdfunding, I was very happy to see that their entire document clearly segregated rewards-based crowdfunding, equity-based crowdfunding, loan-based crowdfunding. They had done their homework. So
the kind of investors that are there on board, they did the first round of investments. Now they have done the second round of investments.
Yeah.
So their belief in the concept has gone deeper.
Yes.
So what has made them do that? What is the belief system that you have built for them?
I think they like it when our films get national awards. Or they like it when our musicians go abroad and do shows and, you know, sort of do all of those things. I think they also, as investors, they also know somewhere that raising money is an issue. And I believe that everybody is an artist in the country. So, you know, given a chance, nobody would become an engineer or a, you know, doctor and all. So I think they all know that. They all have gone through the same thing and they want to make it easier for the creative industry. Also, obviously, numbers talk, right? They're also not just doing this emotionally. They are seeing that we are raising money, growing year on year. It is growing at a good pace. They gave us money to launch now another product, which is going to have a different kind of a model. There's a third thing that we are going to do next year. So, you know, there's like lot of things that they are very excited about, and so are we.
So it's all conceptualization and ideation and coming into action.
Yeah.
So that keeps the investors also excited and they keep on
yeah.
investing the money. And the most intelligent investors in the country who are there on board. That's very interesting. And
You also funded an app called Lovability.
Yes.
So Lovability is a very interesting app, friends. Lovability is the first app in the world which does matchmaking for the differently abled people. A very fantastic concept. And the app got funded on Wishberry.
Yeah.
So do you pick up the concepts? Who does the final selection? Do you have a department or a team which does the selections of the concept that needs to be backed up by Wishberry?
Yeah, so it's all me. I go through projects every day. We get about 100 projects a month, and we end up choosing 30% of them. Lot of them get rejected.
So what is the time that takes? What is the turnaround time that takes for promoting a particular concept from the day that it comes to you to going on to the web?
A total of 60 days.
And how many people are involved in that process of 60 days?
One person with one campaigner.
One person with one campaigner, and then that goes live.
Yeah.
And you people get updated all the time as the campaign becomes popular.
Yeah, so we assign a project consultant to a project creator. At a time, a project creator is handling about 5 campaigns a month, and they make sure that they raise funds. The thing is, our commissions are also tied to whether the person reaches his goal or not. So we just make sure that they do.
The person has to reach 100% funding, only then they get the funds.
Yes.
Otherwise the concept is cancelled.
Yes. Also.
So what is your success ratio?
70%.
Is that better than Kickstarter and Indiegogo?
Overall in the world, yeah.
Overall in the world.
Yeah.
The percentage of success is higher.
Yes.
Fantastic, fantastic, fantastic.
But then again, I mean, we have a lesser denominator right now. I mean, they have like millions of
but
projects.
But when you talk about statistics, it is always in percentage. Nobody goes into the big numbers.
I'm just trying to be humble. So,
so in that part of the game, the success percentage
is
better.
The highest, and we have maintained this for the past 5 years. That's actually more magical than that number itself.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
When you work on these kind of concepts, these are all strategies.
Yes.
You need to keep on updating your strategies and coming up with new ideas.
How do you do that?
What is your learning edge? What is your learning edge?
Every time, I mean, whenever there's a project that we get, we need to think about who will fund this, right? So for example, this Gunga Pehlwan thing. Who do you go to? Apart from his fans and followers, it has to go on the media. So, okay, let's go after people who believe in sports. There are so many sports Facebook communities going there. Then reaching out to some celebrity tweet, to tweet about this concept. There was another project, which was also a very interesting project, to NID children. They wanted to break the myth of menstruation. So they wanted to do this through
a comic book.
It's called Menstrupedia. And they were taking this first to your general investors to give them 5 lakh rupees to make the first 10,000 copies. Obviously, everyone thought this is a taboo topic. Nobody is going to do this. So they said, let's go to crowdfunding. They raised 6 lakhs from about 280 people. 70% men gave money. And after that, PNG noticed. Whisper, the brand, they noticed. And then they came on board saying that now we're going to take you under our wings. And now that comic book is in 10 languages, not just in India, but even abroad.
Fantastic. So thanks to Wishberry, it was a launch pad for them to take a high jump.
Absolutely. Even
Fantastic.
The Lovability app has been funded now by, invested into by, I think, some really big, I'm forgetting the name, but some really big investors. They got their angel funding. After.
Fantastic. One last question before the audience gets into interaction with you. What are the further ambitions for Wishberry?
So we're coming out with 2 more products. One is going to make artists get some sustainable income every month. So what we're doing is that we're giving them a platform. It's going to be called Triber, where they can start their own channel. But to be on this channel as a fan, you have to subscribe by giving maybe 200 bucks a month, 500 bucks a month, 1,000 bucks a month. And that artist is going to give you back a lot more than what he generally produces. So for example, if he's a musician and you're a fan, you go to all of his shows and you want to, be a part of his tribe, he will say that if you give me 200 rupees a month, I will put you on all the guest lists. I can come and do an unplugged night at your, one of your special events or personal occasions. I will share all the lyrics with you. I will take your feedback for my work. I will also give you songs that I may not release for the public. So all sorts of exclusive things so that these artists start raising money monthly now. And our goal is that every artist should be able to raise at least a lakh a month to be able to, be in a nice space.
Fantastic. So that will be a very, very organized and a structured format to need yes. help the actual needy in yes. the creative space. Yes. Fantastic. The
second product that we're coming out with is, have you guys heard of Netflix?
Yes.
Right. So Netflix is a great platform for looking for great shows, films now online, and then, you know, you don't have to really go out now. But on Netflix, unfortunately, it is going to become like YouTube. You can't really find what you want to see. Whatever it will keep suggesting to you, you will see it. So what will happen is all these independent filmmakers, they will still again not get footage on Netflix. Netflix will obviously be promoting all the big cinema and all of that. So in the third and the fourth year sometime, we are going to launch a similar service like Netflix, but we will only have independent cinema on it. So, you know, films
fantastic,
like Parched
fantastic.
Or film like Dhanak or films like
Haramkor.
All these films are going to be here, so you can then see like, okay, I want to watch some intelligent cinema, let me just go here instead of Netflix. So that's what.
One last question. This is a 100% technology dependent business model.
Yeah, yeah.
So what is your technology domain knowledge in the group, in the entity, and what is your dependence on external resources for updating and making it sharper by the day, the technology?
Yeah, so both me and Priyanka are non-technology founders. I mean, I studied English literature. I haven't done my engineering or MBA. Priyanka is a materials engineer, far from computers or anything. So
you all also wasted your education, like those two doctors.
Actually, I haven't wasted my education. I love my time at Miranda House. But no, so both of us did not have a technical background. So in the first few years, obviously, we struggled. But this time, we got a little lucky. We have an investment from a company that makes a lot of international websites, international products. Their offices are only in LA, and they work only for products abroad. So we got in touch during our fundraising to that team, and they invested in us. So we thought, why don't you only create or manage our technology? So our investor is technically managing technology. So, you know, he has to make sure it works.
I'm sure you have a better pitch than what you explained to us. Because you are getting everything done with a smile and very good pitch. So I'm sure you're not sharing that.
Being a woman.
So friends, the questions from your side now. We'll be allowing only 5 questions. So be quick. 5 questions. Oh, when I said 5, there are more hands raising up.
Yeah, I think he
then
has a question.
Quick questions. Yes.
Go for it.
Aniket.
What is your exact revenue model?
Okay.
And when you raised money, how are you planning to pay your investors back?
Okay. So, my investors or the people who are funding projects?
Your investors.
Our investors. Okay. So, we take 10% of the money that every project raises on using Wishberry. And I mean, for us, I think when we hit profit, I think there'll be dividends, or we will get sold, or we will go public. Either ways, I mean, I don't know. There are 3 ways to actually show exit. So one of those things will happen.
Smriti.
Yeah. So how involved are the investors in your organization, and how often do you have to meet them?
So meeting is not, I mean, I think face-to-face meeting almost never happens. But we send them monthly updates on what's going on. We have a monthly team meeting actually with, you know, what's going on, so that we tell everybody what's going on. And that same document is sent to the investors every month. Our main investor who's on the board, Sharad Sharma, he and both of us, we meet him quarterly. So that's about it.
Yeah, Radha. Sorry, Rohit.
Yeah, you just talked about, you know, the perks of being a woman, but still, in the initial times, you know, there might have been some people who were naysayers, and, you know, they may be putting down and pulling down and all that. So how did you manage it? And till today, it's a promoter's organization, so have you become professional completely?
So, you know, this is what I say a lot. Being a woman is actually a filter. If someone gets, you know, scared of you because you're a woman, or gets nervous about your performance because you're a woman, he will show it, and that's a great thing, because I don't want to work with them, you know. So I think being a woman is in itself a filter for all the people who think that, you know, they can't do anything. So we never used to, and this is this kind of discrimination is not something that only men do. I mean, I've met women who've asked me point blank, okay, so what about after marriage? As if, you know, I'll just shut the door and go somewhere, and I don't know. So women have also asked me this question, and I think we don't really worry about this too much. I mean, I'm sure people have seen different things growing up, and that's why they are biased, and you move on, and then you go to some other person. I mean, 60 investors we have, and out of that, one woman is there. You know, all of them are actually men who've invested in the company. So
obviously, that was quite obvious.
Yeah.
Who's the next one? Yeah, Kunal.
Since creativity is very abstract and there is a lot of subjectivity, how do you ensure that you are not selecting projects according to they being commercially funded?
Yeah. So I think that's a fantastic question you asked me there, because that's exactly what we did not want to do, right? Like, then I would not be different from any other...
Because you have to pay your investor.
Yeah.
You would start choosing projects which you think are more likely to get funded. Therefore,
yes,
the creativity which you really wanted to come will not come.
Right. So when we started, we thought that we will not choose projects based on how creative they are or commercially viable they are. The only thing that we look for is, do you have a work in progress? That's it. If you have a work in progress, then I will put you in front of the public and let the public decide. That's the whole point of crowdfunding.
Yeah, so since you are only focusing on the creative projects, would you act as a consultant if somebody wants to start their own funding, crowdfunding company?
Creating your own, supporting your own competition is what he's asking.
No, not competition, because she's focused
on the creative. In other words, sleeping with the enemy.
Because you're focusing only on creative projects.
If the other one doesn't focus on creative?
Yes, like suppose I want to start on engineering projects only.
No.
Thank you.
Yeah, Sandeep.
How are you? Are you democratic? Like suppose one project of you gets successful in some ways. So do you fund them or do you actually fund other and you give chance to other people? I mean, how do you kind of, what is your modus operandi? Where do you kind of... Or you are democratic, like, you know, no, you give chance to other one, not because he is successful?
No. So we actually don't take these calls. Hmm. If somebody has a project, they just put it up on our website. And then we help them take this project on our website to other people using social media. So for example, think of it as a Facebook profile. Say you have a Facebook profile on Facebook. Think of the same profile as a project profile on Wishberry. You'll have a link saying wishberry.in/ whatever the name of your project is. Then you take this and tell everybody on social media, your email, everyone you've met in your life that, you know, this is what I'm doing. This is the communication we help you with, and also other things like how do you get the press to write about you or your project which is raising money, how do you get the Twitter influencers to tweet about this, and then we see who funds you. So we don't give any money or collect a fund to distribute. But we just help you go to the public and raise money from them.
Okay.
Fantastic. Thank you, friends. Paucity of time. So you ask questions for the next session. So I would like to request Suhani to get the mementos. That was awesome, Anshulika. Thanks a ton. It was lovely. It was lovely. And I knew you would be flawless because you are used to this now. I would like to request Mr. Tony to come up, please, and hand over the memento to Anshulika.